Our speaker tonight is Dr. Lee Smith. Dr. Smith has given several talks over the years. I've just learned a little more than several, quite a few talks over the years at our education meetings, and he's always been a favorite. His list of accomplishments are impressive. Dr. Smith is currently the Director of Stress Medicine at the Center for Mind-Body Health in Salt Lake City. He is an internist with a subspecialty in behavioral medicine, and he has chaired national curriculum committees in this area. He established the Stress Medicine Clinic at the University of Utah, where he was Clinical Associate Professor of Medicine. He previously was Medical Director of the Behavioral and Stress Medicine Task Force at LDS Hospital in Salt Lake City, and where he was also Vice Chairman of the Department of Internal Medicine. He was a co-founder of the Institute for Spirituality and Healing in Medicine, and his research interests have centered on defining the types of medical disorders associated with anxiety and depression, on chronic pain problems, and on the effects on health outcomes of effectively treating stress issues. He co-authored a widely used textbook entitled Mind-Body Health, The Effects of Altitudes, Emotions, and Relationships, and it's currently in its fifth edition. So with all of that, I'm excited to hear your talk. Dr. Smith?
Thank you, Mary Sue. Okay, so find it right to stand here. So again, as the title suggests, our focus tonight is on things that you can do, separate from medicine, that works on this hypersensitivity of the central nervous system that underlies fibromyalgia and things like it. I'm going to briefly review what we mean by that hypersensitivity. Some of that will be a review for many of you. And then I think I'm quite fascinated, at least, with the things that you can do, those that you'll often talk about, and they're things that significantly increase the quality of life with these disorders, whether they're there or not. And the quality of life for all of us, as a matter of fact. Well, let's see. So. There we go. Okay. First point is that fibromyalgia is a prototype of what we call central pain syndrome. So what we mean by that is this. Oh goodness, let's see, where am I getting all this feedback? Let's see if I can stand over here. If you kind of think about it, there are two large kinds of pain. One is where you've got something out in the tissue that's been damaged, and that sends a pain signal in and can cause pain. The other is where the central nervous system starts to hypersensitize and now over-respond to any pain signals coming from the periphery. It turns out that a lot of chronic pain, not just fibromyalgia, is related to this nervous system hypersensitizing and winding up. Let me show you a little bit about how some of that occurs. After we mentioned this, how fibromyalgia is diagnosed. Now, this will sound familiar to you, but I have a reason for discussing this. One is chronic widespread pain. Now, widespread means all four quadrants of the body, right, left, upper, and lower. And chronic means greater than 3 months. Now, the reason that's not just arbitrary, 3 months is set off because if you have something that causes acute pain and then it keeps going on after 3 months, after things should have healed up, it usually involves the central sensitization problems. And we'll come back to that. The tender points of fibromyalgia, and I'll come back and show you those in a moment. The deep sleep abnormality. We have 3 stages of sleep, 4 stages of sleep. You've got light sleep, stage one, and stage two, which is covered in most of the sleep, and stage three, which is deep sleep, where your body is repaired and is the deep refreshing kind of sleep. And then there's dream sleep, which is very different than deep sleep. And people with fibromyalgia skip deep sleep. If you take normal people and just cause them to skip deep sleep, they start getting achy and tender points that for all the world look like fibro coming on just by depriving a person of deep sleep. Now tonight, we're not going to talk about the sleep issues, and there's some things you can do about your sleep, but the reason I'm not going to talk about that is that we had a full discussion of that, and it's on the Bateman Horne Center website and in a past education meeting about sleep. Very important, but not for tonight. And the other piece are the overlapping hypersensitivity disorders. If you have a person with widespread pain and none of these other disorders, it may well be something other than fibromyalgia. Let's just for a second show you the tender points. You're probably very familiar with these. These are sort of classically described in these places that are marked dark. There's nothing magical about these spots. Let's suppose we take this one right up here in the trapezius. If we were to biopsy the muscle, you don't see anything in the muscle. It's not a muscle disorder. Let's just do this right now on yourself, whether or not you have fibro. Find this little place in the middle of the trapezius and see if there's not a little tender spot there in all of us. And then maybe you're outside your shoulder and you'll find that this doesn't hurt as much as this hurts. It controls. These little spots are places that are a little more sensitive in all of us. But they don't really hurt a lot normally. The reason we use these little spots is it's an objective test. You just push on these places that are a little more sensitive in everybody, but in somebody whose nervous system is hypersensitive to pain, it's a little objective test is how hypersensitive is the pain system. The points are about. And then these are the other very common central nervous system hypersensitivity disorders that go along with fibromyalgia. For example, the most common diagnosis that comes out of a gastroenterology clinic. Half of everybody who goes to a gastroenterologist has a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome. Well, if you do the tests for the gut, they're all normal. It's not really a gut problem, it's a problem of the nervous system over-responding to gut signals. A little gut signal is amplified to a big gut signal. Just like with fibro, a little pain signal is amplified to a big pain signal. And about 30-40% of people with fibro will have irritable bladder, very common disorder. Urine frequency and urgency, do your analysis, it's normal, it's not an infection, it's just smooth muscle spasm. You get a bladder signal and the nervous system causes contraction. It's like it does with the bowel, with irritable bowel syndrome. Non-cardiac chest pain, the most common cause of chest pain, which usually the tests are normal for, and it can be related to esophageal spasm or to tenderness in the chest wall. And there are a whole host of different pieces to the puzzle, but this is the most common cause of chest pain, is a hypersensitivity problem. Headaches, the most common pain problem in primary care settings. Well, if you think of migraine, stuff hurts that shouldn't hurt. Light hurts, smells hurt, sounds hurt. What you start getting a picture of is this nervous system over-responding to things that shouldn't be bothersome. It's this twitching nervous system. Restless legs. A fair number of people have trouble, you know, when they go to bed, and just little discomfort, there's something makes them have to move their legs around. It's a dopamine problem. We'll come back to that in a minute, which is abnormal in fibromyalgia. And anxiety disorders. If you think about an anxiety disorder, now you have a stress signal. Something that's a little bit fearful, and it's too much. So you start getting this picture, you see, of a nervous system that's over-responding, not only to pain too much, but to a whole host of other things. If you don't have any of these other things, it may well not be fibromyalgia. There are other things that can cause widespread pain. So let's talk a little bit about how does this hypersensitization of the nervous system occur, and whom is it more likely? Here's the kind of the process that usually happens. You'll have a genetic predisposition. Now with fibro, we've identified four or five genes. There are undoubtedly a number of others, high candidates, that set you up to have a more vulnerable nervous system if certain things happen. And the gene problems can cause some neurotransmitter issues that we'll get to in a moment, and can cause some sleep problems. And then you'll have a triggering event. So here's a person that's doing fine with this inherited genetic predisposition, and then you'll have a triggering event. It might be an acute pain problem. You know, maybe the injury in the back, or you injure your neck. And that pain, that triggering event, starts a pain process over a little period of time that then triggers this hypersensitization, and then even after the injury goes away, the nervous system pain takes on a life of its own. That often happens also with things like irritable bowel syndrome. You know, you'll have this vulnerability without any problems, and then get a kind of a bad gastroenteritis, a viral infection. And it sensitizes the gut, and then the infection goes away, but the gut stays too sensitive. Now, tonight, we're going to talk on just a little different level about a thing called the amygdala. And I just want to quickly summarize here these neurotransmitter problems and the triggering events can activate a part of the brain called the amygdala. Now, don't worry about what that is right now, but it'll become evident with a little further discussion. And when the amygdala in the brain gets activated, it tends to cause the nervous system to wind up and over-respond to stimuli for a number of reasons. So things that can help quiet that part of the brain can be helpful to this whole process. Just hang on to that for a moment. I'm not going to explain it right now. I'm going to come back to this little pain pathway diagram and just summarize some things. So here's some pain pathways. Let's see, I don't have a pointer, but out here at the bottom left, you'll have something in the tissue generating a pain signal. And then what you see is that pain signal goes on a nerve into the spinal cord. And there in the spinal cord, you see the release of some pain amplifying neurotransmitters. For example, substance P and glutamate. So we're going to transfer the signal to this nerve going up to the brain. The pain signal goes up to the brain, and then stuff happens in the brain. We're going to come to that in a moment. But the brain sends signals back down the spinal cord to inhibit the pain. And those inhibitory tracts are driven by at least these four neurotransmitters that I've shown here on the slides: norepinephrine, dopamine, serotonin, and down in the spinal cord, some GABA. And that happens down here in the synapse. Now, the synapse is where all those nerves come together down in the spinal cord. these inhibitory neurotransmitters are released to block the signal going out. The genetic problems often involve abnormalities of those inhibitory neurotransmitters. There are some problems genetically with norepinephrine or with dopamine or serotonin, for example. So you're not getting as many of the neurotransmitters that inhibit the pain, but you get too much of the substance being glutamate that amplify the pain down in the cord itself. When you lack the inhibition, then a little pain signal uninhibited or a little gut signal uninhibited becomes amplified and you get too much. So we traditionally, even with medicines, looked a lot at that little synapse where I've circled it down in the spinal cord. But it turns out that it's a bigger story than just the spinal cord. And that comes to this amygdala and some other of the pain processing centers up in the brain. Now, again, hang on to that for a minute. We'll come back and explain why I'm describing that. So here's a little summary. If you take cerebral spinal fluid out of a person with fibromyalgia or some of the other hypersensitivities, and you measure these neurotransmitters, you find problems with low central serotonin in the cerebral spinal fluid. Serotonin lacking contributes to some of the problems with sleep and with anxiety. Low central norepinephrine plays a big role in the pain problems and in thinking and in fatigue. The low dopamine function plays a role in being able to focus, attention, think, the restless legs, some of the grinding of teeth. The enjoyment of things is a dopamine issue. The high substance, in the cerebral spinal fluid, not only do you have a lack of these inhibitory neurotransmitters consistently, but you have too many of the pain amplifying neurotransmitters. Now, this will be my momentary mention of medications, because our talk tonight is not about medications. But the ones that are approved for fibromyalgia, what you see are antidepressants that work up here on norepinephrine and dopamine and serotonin, things like sertraline or Cibella that have been approved or by trying to increase these inhibitory neurotransmitters. On the horizon, there are a couple of new things coming out, one of which is like the Cibella. Okay, so it's not any breakthrough, but it might have a few benefits. Let's see. Things that work down in the cord on the receptors of or on the release of substance P glutamate or some of the anticonvulsants, things like Lyrica and Gabapentin. They tend to reduce how much substance P glutamate amplifying neurotransmitters are released. And we have a thing coming out that's very much like the Lyrica, probably in the very near future. I think more interestingly, we're going to be seeing some things that act to block the effect of the For example, what are the effects of ways of thinking on these same neurotransmitters? When a person, these studies that show this are fascinating, but we don't have time to really walk into all the details of these studies. I'll just have to summarize them. Okay, if a person gets an internal sense of control, up goes serotonin, kind of like using an SRI. However, But let's talk about that just for a minute, because this is kind of an important idea. It's not about control of the world out there. It's not control of what's causing my illness necessarily. It's really, I'm in control of me. Whether the pain and fatigue is here or not, it doesn't control me. I do. The ancient Hindus would say, if what's out there is really bothering you a lot and it feels like it's just taking you over, making you miserable and you're suffering because of what it, the Hindus would say, you're giving your power away to it. And your power, they would say, is yourself, your real self. And they would just say, simply, call your power back. Be the you you want to be, regardless of it. So this internal locus of control has a lot to do with not controlling the external world, but control of me with whatever's out there. Okay, now we'll come back to that in a bit. There's another interesting, these are ways of thinking and their effects on these neurotransmitters. Love, cooperation, sense of connectedness raises dopamine. Dopamine is the neurotransmitter of love. I think I've mentioned this to a couple of you before. When I was at the university, I had this group, these were all women who have fibromyalgia and these other things that go with it, who came in and said, it's gone. I was great. I said, what did you do? I fell in love. Kind of adoringly, passionately in love, and all this stuff went away. And then when the symptoms came back, the key question was, how's this new relationship going? And it makes some sense because, you know, you increase the stomach, inhibits the pain, helps you feel good. Exercise, getting turned on, having purpose. Purpose about your life, purpose about this event, raises the norepinephrine, the dopamine, the endorphins. It all feels like, well, this disease is controlling me and I can't do anything that I love doing. Purposeless, you're going to lose those neurotransmitters. Deep relaxation. A sense of calmness with whatever comes up raises these things here. The sleep, serotonin, increases sympathetic tone, raises fat. Now notice here, I want you to notice a little head. We're talking about things you can do tonight that affect the neurochemistry of these common disorders. One is, how do I gain this inner sense of control, regardless of what's out there? Second one, love, or sense of connectedness, purpose and meaning, and this calmness in the face of the storm, and mindfulness. We'll come back to what mindfulness is about in just a minute. Now, the reason this is neurochemically is fascinating to me is Mary Sue mentioned a textbook that we've written for a number of years where we've gathered hundreds of studies on the effects of mental things like attitudes and emotions and relationships on health outcomes. These are measurable health outcomes. And I might add, the definition of health by the World Health Organization is not the absence of disease, but it's a sense of total well-being in all of its dimensions, not just physically, but mentally, socially. It's total well-being is what health is. Well, this internal locus of control is one of those principles with lots of data. You have that, you have better health, physical and mental. But again, the internal locus of control is not control. controlling the world, but it's being able to respond to what's out there according to your own deeper wisdom, the way you would admire someone who's really got it together, that you would deeply admire, handling this difficult situation. Able to do that according to your own inner wisdom, you feel an internal locus of control. So it's an integrity issue. The second one, this can sound familiar, the sense of connectedness has powerful effects. People who feel isolated and alone have a lot more health outcomes than people who have some loving support, who feel loving themselves and support themselves towards others. A sense of oneness rather than separateness. Rather than you being over there and I'm over here, and how do we compare to people? It's friends. People have better health. I was fascinated. This is a little aside. Read this book a little while back called Healthy at 100. There are little pockets of places in the world, that, you know, a place in Nepal and Okinawa and Central America. A number of places where people in their 90s and 100s are very healthy. And they went to try and figure out what do they do in common. These are very different cultures. What do they do in common to have healthy old people? And there's things about nutrition and exercise. But one of the things I was fascinated with is almost invariably these old folks had a small group of friends that they got together with regularly and laughed a lot. You might want to think about scheduling a regular time to get together with a little group of friends and just laugh, connect, okay? Raises dopamine, okay, if you do that. Here's the fourth, a third one. A sense of purpose and meaning. And that has to do both about one's life, one's work. And it doesn't have to be grand work. It's anything that's really important to you. You know, one of the great books is a mother or a grandmother and her care for your kids. Whatever is important to you, that you feel a sense of purpose, that reason to get up in the morning. And it's not only about one's life, but it's a sense of purpose and meaning for this event. You know, what is this here teaching me? How can I learn something from this? How can I turn this into something of value? People who see the world that way have better health than people who feel like it's all purposeless and meaningless. And the fourth one, and there's lots of data, this is strong data for these 4 points. And then the fourth one is hope. You know, medically, one of the most proven things we have in medicine is the placebo effect, including for chronic pain. A third of people with chronic pain respond well to a placebo if you expect it to work. But there's a little caveat about the kind of hope that affects health outcomes. And that is, it's not about attachment to a certain outcome. If this happens, I have hope for this to happen, but if it doesn't happen, then you're kind of devastated. The kind of hope that this is about is that with whatever comes up, I can deal well with this. I can respond to this in a way that's valuable, meaningful, integrity. Bring it up. That's the kind of hope. If you kind of think about those little things, there's sort of a spiritual element. Most of the spiritual traditions go for these very things. How to have the integrity, your deep wisdom, and how to be more compassionate, and how to find purpose to your life. Hope, I think, okay? So, you know, this total well-being may have to do with spiritual well-being as well, from whatever tradition. Or individual, whether it's, doesn't have to be necessarily even religion. Here's another interesting deal. If you take a look at studies of stress resilience, I won't explain this, but just for example, many years ago, Suzanne Kobasa and Sal Manning studied people going through major stressful events, like, you know, middle-aged men that lost their careers and now they're trying to figure it out again. And some of them thrive and are very resilient, and some of them it blows them away. And so they took a look at what's the difference in their approach as to how they handle it. They described three C's: an internal locus of control, sense of connectedness, and seeing this as a challenge, which has to do with this purpose, meaning, and hope. Challenge rather than, oh, no, I mean. These same principles are the keys to stress hardiness, they call it. Many years ago, Abraham Maslow, anybody to a psych, remembers Abraham Maslow at Psych 101, okay? He studied a group he called self-actualizers, people who had found fulfillment in life, and meaning, and joy in life. And he had about a dozen characteristics that were common to this group of people. If you look at them carefully, many of them are variations on the theme of these four things, of actualizing your real self. Back to that also. And a final one, Martin Seligman, University of Pennsylvania, for years has studied what are the elements of human happiness when people are really, genuinely happy. What causes your happiness? And what you find is these same elements keep coming up. And this is the total world case. So the things we're going to be talking about tonight are not just about how to reduce the pain, help the fatigue. They do that. But it's about this quality of life, whether the fibro or the fatigue is here or not. Now, let's come back to our little diagram and look at it a little differently. So remember, this is the pain pathways, the signals coming in, out of the tissue to the core, going up to the brain. And here's what happens in the brain. It goes out to this sensory cortex and registers it as pain. If I put my hand on a hot stove, registers that hurts in my hand because of that. But sometimes we forget that this same pain signal going up to the brain also goes through what's called the limbic system, which is the part that elicits emotion and makes me afraid to touch the stove. Now why do we have pain? Why do we have fear? What are they for? Okay, yeah, because me pull my hand off the scope so I don't wreck my hand. It's there to protect me, isn't it? Pain. And the fear is too. If I'm afraid to touch the stove, it's going to protect me. So we need pain and we need the fear. But the problem with these disorders we're talking about tonight, there's too much. It's no longer protective. It's too much. It's dysregulated. It's a disorder of itself because it's too far. Well, here are some things that sensitize the nervous system to over-respond. Anxiety, anger, loss of control, over-attention. Think about this for a minute. This is very practical, as we'll see further. In the nervous system, whatever you give your attention to is amplified, and what you neglect is inhibited. And probably all have seen this. Let's just imagine you're at a big party, and you and I are in a conversation, parents do. But there's lots of noise and tumult and chaos going on at the party. But as we give complete attention to the conversation, what happens to the noise? Disappears, doesn't it? This is the nervous system inhibiting the unimportant stuff to allow you to give, to amplify what we're giving attention to. If I give my attention to all the noise, I lose the conversation. So this is a very important part to think about. What do I want to give my attention to and thus amplify it? And what do I want to neglect and thus inhibit? Poor sleep sensitizes the nervous system. We've all kind of experienced that. You've been sleep deprived. Not just the nervous system gets irritable, you get irritable. When you're sleep deprived. And one of the reasons is sleep deprivation, particularly deep sleep deprivation, reduces those inhibitory neurotransmitters. Remember, serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine, they fall when you're sleep deprived. So sleep's a very important piece. Now, what are some things that desensitize this twitchy nervous system? Well, it kind of makes some sense. It's getting calm. It's taking some rest, getting calm, centered, and quiet. It's going to quiet this twitchy nervous system. Love and compassion does. I fell in love. And all that stuff diminishes. Oh, the sense of control, these things that we talked about before. Some kinds of music. The ancient Greeks used music a lot for these kind of disorders that we're talking about. And touch. If touch feels connected rather than scary. Well, this gets kind of interesting because I'm going to talk here now about our two minds. And one of them has to do with what has traditionally, in some of the ancient traditions, been called the little ego. And this is where, again, you and I see each other as separate. My ego. Here over there. How do we compare? Who's cool? Who's got the power? Who's right? Who's wrong? Who's liberal? Who's conservative? We get caught up in this separateness, which is driven a lot by being judgmental and fearful. Okay? And that's driven by this part of the brain called the amygdala, the non-overdrive. Hang on to that. On the other hand, all of these desensitizers come from a thing we would call the wise mind and the loving mind or compassionate mind. And that involves a thing called the prefrontal cortex and anterior cingulate. Let me show you that. Just a moment. So one of the questions that comes up, if we have these disorders that are too sensitive, how do we transform from too sensitive to activate the desensitization process? What can you do to affect this neurochemistry that sometimes we're trying to do with medicines? Well, let's just for a second talk about this thing about our two different minds. I'll explain why maybe you are two different minds. And incidentally, each of these minds respond very differently to the stresses of life. Let me just briefly tell you the story of Viktor Frankl. You may remember these sort of classical stories of man's search for meaning, the book that you wrote. Frankl was an academic physician in Vienna. But as a Jew in World War II, was interred in a series of Nazi concentration camps ending in Auschwitz. And in this worst of stressful situations, because of his academic curiosity, he watched how people were responding to this terrible situation. And he noticed it's like there are two groups. The majority felt very victimized, very vulnerable, very out of control, frequently dying at high rates. But he also noticed another group that tended to survive and die much less calmly and be more resilient. Now the difference between these two groups are the difference between these two minds. One of the minds causes most of our difficulties and problems. And the other one usually has wise solutions to those problems. Let's put just a little neurochemistry to it. The limbic system that you see in the middle, I've mentioned, is the part that elicits emotion and often automatic habit responses, and tends to be highly controlled by this part called the amygdala. The amygdala's job in the brain is to protect you. So it's always scanning for danger. And incidentally, we share this mind with primitive animals. Are you safe? Is that safe? What was that sound? So the amygdala's there for a reason. But it's always scanning for danger. It sees us as separate. And it becomes judgmental. You're not doing that right in my way. So it becomes judgmental and gets angry. And so what I'm calling that up at the top is sort of our fear and anger mind. And reasons for it. But what you see with these hypersensitivity disorders when you put people in functional scanners is the amygdala is on overdrive. It just lights up. And when the amygdala is on overdrive, it causes the whole nervous system to over-respond. Okay, the other mind centers in this prefrontal cortex. You see up here in the front part of the brain. And the prefrontal cortex is sort of our voice of reason and wisdom. And it's always sort of kind of talking to the amygdala and saying, hey, don't get too excited, you can handle this, you know, it just kind of voice of reason. And it connects a lot to these other two parts, the anterior cingulate and this right anterior insula, that have mirror neurons in them that allow us to feel empathy and compassion and love. And these parts of the brain kind of run in tandem with each other. And this is what we experience more in humans. The humans have these parts. Now, the reason I'm calling it two different minds is, in the scanners, when one of these is activated, the other is inhibited. When you have disorders that cause nervous system hypersensitivity, sometimes it's kind of hard to... In fact, it makes pretty common sense. If you're in a situation feeling lots of anger and fear, it's kind of hard to feel wise and loving. But when you're really deep connecting, wise and loving place, the fear just sort of subsides. So, what can we do to activate the wise and loving mind and thus inhibit this fearful, judgmental victim? It's a really interesting question. It's not just a matter of getting rid of fear or getting rid of pain. It's what can I do instead that just naturally gets rid of that stuff? How can we move more solidly into this wise, compassionate mind? Two things. One is conscious intent. The other is a whole bunch of practices. Intent, meaning, once we're aware of the difference between these two minds, and we don't have time to go into all the detailed differences, but you can kind of get a sense, those four principles, proven to improve health outcomes, proven to raise these neurotransmitters that are abnormal, come from the prefrontal cortex, the anterior cingulate, the wise and loving mind. So if you know the difference between these two, you recognize we all have these two. We all use both of them. And if you can recognize, which one am I coming from right now? Which one do I want to come from? And then some practices. What to do rather than what not to. It's not about don't get frightened or don't get angry. Because the brain can't deal with the don't. It needs to know what to do instead. Let's just illustrate that for a minute. It's a little bit off, so not entirely. But let's suppose you wanted to lose weight. And so I said to you, well then, don't even think about chocolate cake. Get it out of your mind. Just for 5 seconds, let's not think about chocolate cake. How are you doing? See what happens? That's right. Don't think about it. And that's true. If you say, don't do this, the brain will be thinking about it, and that picture, was that chocolate cake looking pretty good? Maybe I don't see chocolate cake. You see, if you say, don't do it, if you say, don't get angry, you're going to be feeling all the things that cause the anger and trying to stuff it. It doesn't work. What you have to do is tell it what to do instead. In the case of losing weight, you can say, I only eat healthy foods. And you picture healthy foods you like. You know, lots of fruits and veggies and salads. And they make me feel healthier and lighter. I love to eat that stuff. And sometimes it's like a mantra. I even eat healthy. Oh, there's joke. That's not healthy. I eat. And as you picture that, it's much easier to say, don't eat that. And the same thing applies to these principles we're talking about. Rather than, you know, don't get angry and fearful, it's do these other things that just inhibit that part of the brain naturally. With practices. So what kind of practices have been proven to activate the prefrontal cortex and the anterior cingulate? One of them that would probably make sense is meditation. Just meditated on these principles. We just dwell in it, just practice being in it, you're going to activate that part of the brain. However, there's a step before the practices. The first step is this. You just get still. You get out of this fearful, judgmental thoughts. Just still. You can use your body senses to come fully to the present moment. Well, it's not about what happened before, what's going to happen. Just be here, still. Get out of the old thoughts. Let's just use an illustration. Many of you are familiar with relaxation exercises using things like your breath and your muscles. Let's just practice this just for a second. The breath is very powerful. What I'd like to have you do is notice two different ways of breathing. Just become aware of this. Okay, first, do this. Okay, right now. Take a deep breath in. Now I want you, as we do this, to notice how your mind and your body are thinking. Can't let it out. A little more air in. Still more air in. Can't let it out. Now just breathe shallowly at the top of your lungs. Notice how your mind and your body are feeling. Keep it up. Can't let it out. How did that make you feel?
Dizzy,
tense, not comfortable, anxious. That's kind of interesting, isn't it? You breathe that way, you get anxious. Next time you're feeling anxious, notice how you're breathing. You're very likely to be breathing high and shallow in your lungs. It's just anxious breathing. This is a body-mind thing. You breathe that way, you get anxious. You get anxious, you breathe that way. Now let's breathe differently for a second. Put your hand on your tummy. And now we're going to do some diaphragmatic breathing where the diaphragm comes down, and that will cause you, as you breathe in, your tummy to come up. So just breathe sort of down into your abdomen where your tummy rises. Breathe in. Your tummy rises and falls with the breath. Get your chest rising. Move it down into your tummy. Let that go. Breathe in. As you let it out, notice how your mind and your body feels breathing this way. However, let's take a breath. Let's just let it out. Let it out even more. Let it out even more. Hold it out. Notice what happens. And now you take a breath in. So what happened there?
Dizzy.
It got kind of dizzy again. I mean, if you think about this, this is really kind of fascinating, how your body knows what to do in the moment, what is needed. Do I need to breathe in? Do I need to breathe out? If it's too much in either direction, it becomes unhealthy, uncomfortable. But in any given moment, one of the physiological health principles, is this is true of your hormones and your immune system, just sort of is in a still place, waiting to know whether to increase or to decrease. You know, when all this amygdala stuff is driving on, and it's often too much, it's increasing too much, it's not enough inhibition. But what we want is not either or, it's a still place where your body wisely knows to go to this side or to that side. Would that our Congress were that way. At times when we need to be more conservative and, you know, some principles. And there are times when we need to be more progressive and move forward, come up with things that are new, that aren't scary. If we just get to a still place. Here's another illustration. Progressive muscle relaxation, which has been shown if you do it before bed into a deep sleep. Let's just do this for a second, just momentarily. Take a deep breath in, and as you hold your breath, tense your right arm and fist. Take your mind to the tension. Notice everything about it, what it feels like. And then on the out breath, let your arm fall in your lap. And notice the feeling that kind of flows down into your arm and hands. Very subtle. This is muscle relaxation. Just for a second, put both hands in your lap. And do the same thing, same hand. Take a deep breath in, tense the arm and hand, and notice what tension is. Go to it, become very aware of it. And then with your out breath, transform it into the relaxation. Kind of a little warmer to the feeling. Compare that hand to the other hand right now. Tell the difference. That's muscle relaxation. Now, the reason I'm pointing that is, it doesn't help to run away from the pain and the tension. What helps is to kind of go to it, come became aware of it, and then soften it. Let's just use another illustration. For just a second, in your chair, truth aside, just for a second, grab hold of your knee with your opposite hand, and the arm up on the chair behind you, the other arm. Yeah, if you got your right knee and your right arm on the chair behind you, just to anchor it. Now, what I'd like to have you do, just for a second, is to rotate around to what's called the edge, which means almost too far, but not quite. So you just sort of rotate around, find that edge. You don't have to go beyond, not too far. But find that tight edge, take a breath in, picture that tight muscle, and on the out breath, just soften it. Just soften that edge, just relax, completely let go, no protection. And when you feel it soften, take another breath in, and go a little farther to a new edge. Not too far, but almost too far. Notice the tightness. And then on the out breath, soften the edge. Just transform the tightness into relaxation. Take another breath in. And notice you can go still farther. This gets to be surprising sometimes. When you thought you could only go so far, you can go further and further if you go to the edge and relax it. And there's a message for life in this. Instead of staying away from scary things, you go to them, become aware of them, recognize the muscles are designed to move. If you don't move them, they're going to complain. If you move them too much, they're going to complain. So exercise with fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue is what we call paced exercise. You figure out where that edge is, and just kind of work at the edge and gently start extending it a little more and a little more, rather than being afraid of it, tensing to protect. So, not only for the muscles, but for life. Go to the edge, become aware of it, see it with compassion. The muscles are trying to tell you something. You just say, do this, soften it, and go a little farther. Once you've gotten still and just out of the thoughts, and often many of these things like just breath or muscle relaxation is just something to focus your attention on. Quiets the nervous system itself, but gets out of all those scarier, angry thoughts. And then some practices that activate the wise mind. Let me just quickly summarize. These are all things that have been shown in scanners to turn on that prefrontal cortex. One's mindfulness meditation. There's an interesting study. John Kabat-Zinn and Richard Davidson did this many years ago. These are brand new meditators who are asked to meditate for 15 minutes a day, 3 times a week for 8 weeks. And then they put them in the scanners to begin with. They put them in the scanners to begin with, meditated 3 times a week for 15 minutes for 8 weeks. And then not just when they were meditating, but even the other parts of their day. Unfortunately, we've lost the picture of this, but what happens is it turns on the prefrontal cortex and the anterior cingulate and inhibits the amygdala. In studies of fibromyalgia up in Toronto, people who do the mindfulness meditation, turning on this part, inhibiting that part, even though they felt pain, they felt much less suffering from the pain. The pain may be there, but the suffering is much more optional. That is, the suffering is, how much is this controlling my life? How much is this ruining my life? How much do I have to be miserable? All those questions I've just asked are fear-based, amygdala-based questions. What is mindfulness? Mindfulness is more than just the meditation. Meditation is terrific. It helps you to learn how to bring your attention. Here's what mindfulness is. It has to do with daily being this way, more than just the meditation. Be completely present. So I'm not worried about the past. I'm not worried about the future. I'm not feeling judgmental or not caught up in those things. They're kind of imaginary. But where I am is here. Whatever's here. Present. Which is the only thing you can control, incidentally. You know, the internal locus of control. I can't necessarily control what's here, but there's an acceptance that what is here is here. So I'm not denying what's here, and I'm not resisting what's here. It's just here, just in this moment. And asking myself, from your wisdom, given that it's here, how would I love to really wisely, compassionately respond to this without judgment? Now, judgment's the victim. Compassion, wisdom. Just asking those questions activates your wise mind. Given that what's it just for this moment, how do I respond? With wisdom, love, compassion, kindness, no judgment. Even for people who don't stop. Some of the mindful moments are some of the great moments of our day. Where you're just there without judgment. We could also show a picture of somebody that's caught up in a very challenging situation. Bring wisdom, calmness, deal with this. What effects does dwelling in these wisdom thoughts and practices have on the brain? Here's another. I just couldn't resist throwing this slide in. Incidentally, exercise activates the prefrontal cortex. It turns on norepinephrine and dopamine. So exercise, paced exercise, is one of the practices that can help with your thinking as well. There's a thing called neuroplasticity. It's kind of like muscle. Use it or lose it. And you know how if you exercise a muscle, it gets bigger, stronger. The same thing is true of the brain. I won't explain all of the processes. But what you see is, and here's just an illustration, with long-term meditation, dwelling in these prefrontal thoughts, just like practicing 50 minutes a day, like you might go to the gym and practice. What you literally see is you grow new neurons in the wise and loving parts of the brain. This little graph down there on the right, this is over age. That says ag, but it means age. You can see that the red line is the thickness of the prefrontal cortex just in a population. You can see as you get older, it shrinks. Unless you meditate in it, that's the blue line, and notice that it doesn't shrink if you practice using it. You literally, this is the thickness of tissue we're talking about here, more neurons. You grow neurons, just like you might grow muscle fibers. So if you can realize the difference between these two lines, which one do I want to grow? Make the line. And it grows too, practice it. With the wise and loving mind. Here's a couple of other things. Smiling activates the prefrontal cortex. Did you know your facial muscles tell your brain how to feel? Let's just practice this for a minute. And we're going to have you all close your eyes, take a breath in, and as you close your eyes, make your face go into a grimace, a tight, scary kind of grimace, and notice how your mind and your body feel as you hold your face this way. And let a little more breath in, and then just as you let the breath out, let it fall into a soft smile. And just dwell in the smile. Notice how this makes your mind and your body feel. Just dwell in the smile for a moment. Breathing into it. Maybe even yawning into it. Take a deep breath in. And kind of yawn into the smile. Open your eyes. So, what was the difference between how you felt with the grimace and the smile? Was it significant? What was the difference? It sounds almost kind of too simple. Right? Yes.
Grimace takes a lot more effort.
Oh, yes. And it kind of makes you. It doesn't feel very good. I mean, okay. It's true. Just remember how you put your facial muscles tells your brain how to think. Okay. Waking up in the morning, you might practice this. When you do your progressive muscle relaxation, finish tensing the face. You might even do this when you wake up in the morning. Do some of this progressive relaxation and then just say, waking up this morning. And picture smiling into your day. That sounds, sounds a little weird, but it really does work. You're practicing the prefrontal cortex. And if you want to bless your day in some way, do make a difference, have some purpose and meaning. Induce smiles in other people. How can I help you smile? It's a gift. If I do that, it is a gift to you. If that's your intention, remember where I give my intention. And practice. You find it something as simple as that. Activating the cortex changes the pain. Gratitude. Dwell in the gratitude. You might even consider journaling. This is actually a good study. At the end of the day, review your day backwards, asking some questions like this. What surprised me today? In a good way. What moved me or touched me today? What inspired me today? Something someone did. Some insight that I got. And just dwell with that in gratitude and a sense of meaning for your day. If you do this, after about couple of months, 6 to 8 weeks of doing it at the end of the day, consciously. What you begin to do, if you look for these stories, is you'll just start seeing it in your day. And you'll be feeling the gratitude. And gratitude activates the prefrontal cortex, reduces fear. And the natural outflow of feeling deeply grateful is feeling love. Let it be love. And being more generous, if you feel genuine deep gratitude, now you want to make a difference and find some more meaning. Look for beauty. Do your exercise, go out in a beautiful place and just fill yourself with beauty. That activates the prefrontal mind. And being grateful for the being. Here's kind of an interesting deal. this can be a meditative thing in your prefrontal cortex. If you go out and you see these beautiful plants, think of this as a minute, for a minute. Think of plant life as sort of the essence of love that we take. I think that is. Trees and plants give you oxygen. So you can live. They take away the bad gases. They feed you. They feed your soul with their beauty. We're in this together with the plants and the creatures. And if you go out into a beautiful place, not only dwell in the beauty, but dwell in the gratitude for the love of these plants, you're becoming part of you. I think you see this connectedness. As you do that, you are literally meditating and practicing, turning on this part of your mind. And it gives you the great moments of your day. It's a mindful moment to be there with this beautiful tree. It's great. It's those moments that bring the moments of joy, mindful moments. We're just going to summarize a couple of things. This is studies of non-pharmacological treatment. Lots of studies. Here's some things. Strong evidence, cognitive behavioral therapy and paced exercise really helps the fibromyalgia. And understanding these mechanisms, how I can affect these mechanisms. Somewhat lesser evidence are things like biofeedback, hypnosis, hot baths, those are things that you can. Still less evidence are the things listed here. In a survey of fibromyalgia patients, asking them of all these things that you have done, what for you did you like the best and had the best effect? Things like nutrition and some of these other pieces, they ask them on a 10-point scale, how helpful is it? And it's usually, you know, 3, 4, 5 out of 10 for most of the things on this list. Look at this one. Spiritual practices, whatever your spiritual practices are, 9 out of 10. And half the people found that these were very helpful. Now, this kind of makes some sense if you kind of think of these mechanisms, these principles that we've been talking about. Taking control and integrity of my life. Kindness, wisdom, hope. You see, this not only is it satisfying, it works. So, here's a summary. We're down to our last couple of slides. Quieting, self-treating the fibromyalgia and the sensitivity, quiet the nervous system. And create stress resilience. Get still, transforming tension to relaxation. Instead of protecting, which just causes more pain, you relax into the pain. It's like the muscles are saying to you, relax me. Relax me. It's the only way they can tell you. Stretch to the edge. Talk about that, soften the edge. Both for the muscles and for life's events. Experiential practices, they need to be experiential. Just talking about these ideas doesn't change much, but when you experience it, simple things that activate the prefrontal cortex and your amygdala. Which mind am I in right now? And choose. Have the power to choose which mind. Which one of which mind is the real me? These old habits? Fear, judgment, anger, whatever it is, or a deeper wisdom, which may take some practice to realize the real you. Call your power back. Call your real self back. It doesn't control you. mindful, accept what spirit's here, bringing your wisdom and compassion to your will. Filter your thoughts and responses through those four principles, well proven. Control, connectedness, purposeful, all of which emerge from the white mind. And we've talked about carefully paced exercise, not only physically, but mentally and spiritually. Here are a list of some resources that may be helpful. You can go to this website and download free CD that has called Relaxation Solutions. It does things like the breath or progressive muscle relaxation or some imagery exercises at no cost. There are some courses that apply these principles. Let's talk about them once, it's probably not going to make any difference. But if you go through it step by step experientially, you can really change things, not only for the fiber, but for life quality. If you're interested in mindfulness meditation groups, Tom McConkie is very good at these. He does them both in Salt Lake and Provo. That's his email address. He's starting a new one actually next week, on the 9th, for 6 weeks, kind of an intensive course. I just put this one in because I think this is a wonderful book, an old book, Rachel Naomi Remen. She was a physician who dealt with people with terminal kind of illnesses, things even worse than fibro and chronic fatigue, and gleaned great wisdom from people dealing with these very difficult things. And this is a lovely little book, little short chapters, maybe a chapter or two, three words. Something to dream about. So I'm going to stop there and would be happy to entertain your thoughts or questions about any of these things that we've talked about. I mentioned at the beginning, I think this stuff is even more important than talking about supplements and other kind of things, as helpful as those are, that this gives quality of life whether or not pain and fatigue are here. And helps the patient. So, any thoughts? Yes?
You have mentioned that mindfulness meditation, and you still feel the pain, but there's less suffering. And I was thinking about hypnotherapy along that line.
Yes?
You also mentioned up there that hypnosis had marginal effects. So is hypnosis the same
thing
as hypnotherapy, like self-hypnotherapy?
Yes. I like hypnotherapy and self-hypnosis. The data suggests what you saw here, that there is some minimal data for outcomes. What hypnosis is, if you really kind of think about it, is a deep relaxed state where you get out of all this protective ignorant stuff, literally, so that the protective barriers aren't there, and then you can make some positive suggestions for the prefrontal mind that Nicholas not saying, well, yeah, but, you know, I'm not spiking that, but it's doing all that kind of stuff. So you get rid of all of this explanatory barriers with this getting very still and very relaxed, and then have positive suggestions. So I do like it if it's done by a skilled person. But in terms of just the pain outcome data, it hasn't been robust. Yes?
How do you find a skilled person? Because I had a counselor years and years ago that I trusted with hypnosis for some other issues, but I don't have confidence in finding someone.
I mean, that's a great question. There is a clinical hypnotherapy association with sort of accreditation from academic circles and things that might be a good place to go. I wish I could give you the name of that. You could call up to Dr. Corey Hammond's office at the university in the rehab department. And I think that office could give you a list of people in the community who are credentialed in the reliable program. Yes.
I'm just wondering why my pain seems to be worse when I don't move a lot. And I'm wondering if the exercise and movement, I know it said it helps release positive substances. Is there something else to that, like stretching the movement itself that helps with the pain?
Yes. Okay, so the question was, you know, if you don't move, sometimes you get more pain. Is there something about the movement itself? And the answer is yes. Remember, what are muscles for? They're there to move you. Okay? And they're going to complain if you don't move enough, and they're going to shrink. And I might say, deconditioned muscles hurt a lot more than conditioned muscles. We all have kind of experienced this, perhaps. You're out of shape, and you say, hey, I'm going to go get in shape. Wail into this big exercise thing, you know, and then the next day you're all achy and stiff. I'm talking about non-fibromyalgia, all of this, okay? But as you keep exercising and the muscles get conditioned, that pain goes away. So one of the first principles is conditioned muscles hurt less. But when you've got this hypersensitivity, if you try to do it too fast, they're going to complain a lot more because a little bit of achiness the next day is going to be a lot of achiness. So the pace exercise has to do with starting low and slow. You'll go walking for 5 minutes. Check it out the next day. If it's okay, after a few days, move it up to 10, maybe to 50. What you're doing is going to the edge, pushing it to, and once you find a threshold above which it starts to get too tired and achy the next day, you back down below that threshold, but do it often. The effect of the exercise on these mechanisms only lasts about a day to a day and a half. So you probably ought to do it 3 to 5 days a week, but below the threshold for kicking the symptoms up. And then as you get more conditioned, you'll find you can do a little more. It's like stretching the back, you know, you work at that edge and respond to the muscles. The muscles will say, I don't have any bone. Okay? And you can start to go further and go further.
I have one more question.
Yes.
So can you take supplements for the neurotransmitters, not the natural prescription drug, but like take GABA, that help you with one?
Okay, so that's the question is, can you take pills of these neurotransmitters? In general, those neurotransmitters, you can't take orally because they don't cross the blood-brain barrier. You can take some precursors that cross the blood-brain barrier and then are turned into the neurotransmitters. And you're going to need, now that's a whole other discussion, which we did in one of these states. It's online. I mean, it's on the website. Particularly, you want to, you know, make sure your diet's high in tryptophan and tyrosine, which are the precursors of the norepinephrine and serotonin. You may need some of the vitamins that convert those into the neurotransmitters, like folic acid and vitamin B12. It's a whole other story. Okay, omega-3 fatty acids, you know, the fish oil kind of things that reduce the sensitivity of nerve firing. High doses, 2 grams twice a day, high doses, can sometimes be helpful. So supplements are helpful, but they're not as important as the things we talked about tonight. Yes?
So what about chemical sensitivities? Will this same type of thing address?
Yes. Yeah, nervous system hypersensitivity tends to, well, chemical sensitivity has different pieces to it. The answer is yes. If you're going to get a little symptom, it may well be augmented to a big symptom. But nervous system hypersensitivity can often increase sensitivity in the immune system as well. So people who have multiple allergies frequently will have an anxiety disorder. Treat the nervous system sensitivity and allergies quite a bit. It's not, they're not really two separate systems, they're integrated. Well, I think you've had enough for the evening. I'll be here for a few minutes if I need to have some further questions, but thank you for
coming. This has been very helpful.
Okay.